Okay, let's get started. So thanks everyone for coming to another webinar in additive combinatorics. If you have any questions during the talk, and there's a natural pause in the talk, feel free to unmute yourself and ask your question. You can also ask questions in the chat, but we don't expect the speakers to monitor the chat. So the organizers will see your question in the chat and then interrupt the speaker. So this talk is going to be recorded and put on YouTube, but the question session after the talk won't be recorded. So today we're happy to have Cosmin Pohoata speaking on new lower bounds for the Erdős box problem.
Thank you very much. First of all, thank you very much for inviting me. It's quite a pleasure to speak in the seminar. So this talk will be based on joint work with David Conlon from Caltech and Dmitriy Zakharov from MIPT. Make sure I can switch the slides. So before I begin to tell you about the Erdős box problem, I'd like to collect a few things about the motivating question in low uniformity, the celebrated Zarankevich problem, which was posed by Zarankevich himself in 51, the early days of extremal graph theory. It has arguably become one of the main problems in extremal combinatorics these days. So the question says the following: given a bipartite graph G with n vertices on the left and n vertices on the right, such that G contains no copy of the complete bipartite graph with S vertices on the left and T vertices on the right, what is the maximum size of the edge set of this graph? The classical result in the area is this theorem of Kovarisos and Turan from 54, which says that this quantity is at most a constant times n to the 2 minus 1 over s, s being the smaller of the two parameters. I'll follow tradition and I'll abbreviate this statement by using this notation, the extremal function, the so-called extremal function of the complete bipartite k sub s comma t, being at most a constant times n to the 2 minus 1 over s. This upper bound was known already to be sharp as soon as the theorem appeared in the case when n equals 2. So not too long after, the Zarankevich problem got refined in some sense and into the question of whether this upper bound is sharp or not, or for what parameters SNT is this bound sharp or not. So I'd like to revisit what's known about this. It has been a long series of interesting and beautiful results in this direction. However, the successful one, which actually capture when the upper bound is achieved, can be conveniently abbreviated in one line, or rather two distinct displayed equations. So for t greater than s minus 1 factorial plus 1, this extremal function is indeed of this order of magnitude n to the 2 minus 1 over s. And this holds to the combined work of Kolar, Ronyai, and Szabo from 96, and Alon, Ronyai, and Szabo from 99. Kolar, Ronyai, and Szabo first introducing the so-called norm graphs, which proved this result in the slightly weaker range when t is at least s factorial plus 1, and then the second result adapting this construction, pushing the threshold a little bit further. It is important to emphasize that this incorporates the classical earlier bounds on special cases, which actually involve different constructions than the ones of KRS and ARS. So first there was this construction of this, in some sense, disputed construction for the case when S equals T equals 2 due to Klein from 38 and Riemann from 58 of this incidence graph between points and lines in FP squared. And there's the Brown construction from 66 of point sphere incidence graph in FP cubed, which achieves the maximum number of edges n to the 5 over 3. However, as you can see, when S equals 4, already this result above only gives the correct order of magnitude for the extremal function of K46. the diagonal case S equals T equals 4 is not understood, and in fact, it's perhaps one of the most famous particular cases that's wide open. It's perhaps worth mentioning that this projective norm graph construction of Alon, Ronya, and Sabo actually contains copies of K4-6. In fact, many of them. This is a nice result of Grosu. So in order to say something for that case, one needs something different. Okay, so what about hypergraphs? What is the generalization? One can ask, of course, an analogous question. And in fact, this is precisely what Erdős did in the early 60s. So the notation that we'll use is the following. Let K sub S1 comma S2 comma S sub D with superscript D between round parentheses, denote the D partite, the uniform hypergraph with SI vertices and group I for each I from 1 up to D. I'll stop reading the superscript whenever the uniformity is understood from the context. Similarly, we'll define the extremal function of this D partite uniform hypergraph with this notation. And so this will stand for the maximum number of hyperedges in a D partite uniform hypergraph on D groups of n vertices with no copy of this. Of this complete D-partite hypergraph. Equivalently, perhaps a friendlier formulation to an additive combinatorious crowd is that this is also the size of the largest subset of the D-dimensional grid, which contains no S1 cross S2 cross S sub D box. So by this notation, I mean, as usual, the Cartesian product of the interval of the first n integers with itself taken d times. And similarly, there's an upper bound that Erdős proved generalizing the argument of Kovari-Sosten-Turan. So for every d tuple of integers that I'll order s1 less than s2 less than sd with s1 greater than 2 or at least 2, the extremal function of the complete D partite uniform hypergraph is at most a constant times this quantity n to the power d minus 1 over s1 times s2 times s sub d minus 1. So like in the case of graphs, the question naturally becomes, when is this quantity achieved? As you can see in the case when d equals to this is precisely the Kovari-Sosten-Turan upper bound. So it's achieved in some cases to begin with. So what is known in the context of hypergraphs beyond the uniformity 2 situation? So perhaps not so surprisingly, less is known. This means two things. So on one hand, even in higher uniformity, at least 3, there is a rather degenerate case. For instance, one can take the first d minus 2 values of the SIs to be equal to 1, even though this is not a range that's permissible. With the Zarankiewicz problem for graphs. So the difficult cases from uniformity to carry in some sense in higher uniformity as well. However, there are some truly non-degenerate high uniformity cases that stand out as being difficult, and they're quite poorly understood. And this is, so one of these is the topic I'll from today. So the case when S1 equals S2 equals SD equals 2. This is the range that's also known as the Erdős box problem, where for example, when D equals 3, it's only known that this function is between n to the 11 over 4, the upper bound, this is the Erdős upper bound, and the lower bound is a constant times n to the 8 over 3. And this comes from a construction due to Katz, Krop, and Maggioni from 2002. So this is called the Erdős box problem, I guess, for a couple of reasons. First, it is the obvious one that there's this reformulation in terms of subsets of the D-dimensional grid containing no boxes. However, this applies for the Zarankiewicz problem for hypergraphs in general. Perhaps another tangent to additive combinatorics is that this quantity in the case when S1 equals S2 equals SD equals 2 is related with this classical quantity, the size of the largest subset of the interval from 1 to 10, from 1 to n that contains no affine Hilbert cube of a fixed dimension d. And in that case, the upper bound for that problem that corresponds to this Erdős upper bound has the name the Semeredi cube lemma. And the upper and lower bounds for that problem go hand in hand with upper and lower bounds for the Erdős box problem. Okay, so what else is known about the Erdős box problem? What constructions are there? So like for many, like for all extremal numbers, there is a standard probabilistic deletion argument, which gives a construction. In this case, it gives us the partite graph on the groups of n vertices with no k to 2 2 and with at least a constant times n to the d minus this fraction d divided by 2 to the d minus 1 hyper edges. Since I'll be talking about more complicated deletion arguments in a moment, I'd like to briefly remind everyone how this went. So how one typically proves such things, you start with a random d-partite hypergraph with n groups, with d groups of n vertices, where I consider each edge to be present with probability p independently. This random graph naturally has copies of k to 2 2. However, I can compute precisely on average how many such copies of k to 2 2 are there. I can also compute on average how many edges are there in terms of the probability of an edge being selected. And so what I can do is remove naively one hyper edge from each copy of k to 2 2, destroying all such copies. And then optimizing for the probability p such that I don't remove more than, let's say, a constant proportion of the number of edges at the end. And so this optimization gives precisely this construction with a constant times n to the d minus d divided by 2 to the d minus 1 number of hyper edges. And so while very simple, this deletion argument turns out to be very difficult to beat in this case, like it is in the case for a lot of more complicated graphs and hypergraphs. It took a while until something better appeared, and in fact it did. And it was in 1999 that Gunderson, Rödl and Sidorenko proved the following beautiful theorem. So they proved the following: for every uniformity d at least 2, if S equals the smallest positive integer, such that this fraction S d minus 1 divided by 2 to the d minus 1 is an integer, then this extremal number satisfies this slightly improved upper bound. So there is a construction with n to the d minus d divided by 1 over S, some positive quantity, divided by 2 to the d minus 1. So there's this just extra 1 over S in the exponent from the normal deletion bound. It's important to say, however, that this is not an improvement on the deletion argument in all uniformities. So this integer S may not exist. And it's easy to see that it exists precisely when dn2 to the d minus 1 are relatively prime. So it holds, for instance, for a lot of quantities like prime numbers or powers of 2, but it doesn't hold for many others. So I listed some instances, so 6, 12, 18, 20, 21. In fact, it's easy to see that this number S does not exist for a positive density of integers, because as soon as it doesn't exist for one of the values like 6, it doesn't exist for all the multiples of 6. So if dn to the d minus 1 are not relatively prime, then all the multiples of d have that feature as well. So it's still an interesting question to see if one can beat the probabilistic argument in general for all uniformities. And to see if, and second, if one can further improve this upper bound. So this is our result. So with David and Dmitriy report the following lower bound for the extremal function of the d-dimensional box. So this is a construction of a d-partite d-uniform hypergraph on the groups of n vertices with a constant times n to the d minus the reciprocal of this ceiling function to the d minus 1 divided by d hyperedges. So if one stares a little bit at this exponent, it's a bit funny the way I wrote it. If one removes completely this ceiling function, this is nothing but the original probabilistic deletion bound that I wrote before. However, it's an easy elementary number theory exercise to see that this, for any number d greater than 2, d never divides to the d minus 1. So in fact, this is never an integer. So the ceiling function of this fraction is always strictly greater than the fraction itself. And so this is an improvement over the deletion bound, a polynomial improvement in n over the deletion bound. It's also not difficult to see that it's an improvement over the lower bound of Gunderson, Rödl and Sidorenko for a lot of values of d where their result improved on the deletion bound, except for perhaps mysteriously powers of 2, where our bound is exactly the same as their bound. So, lastly, for when d equals 3, our result also recovers the lower bound due to Katz, Krop, and Maggioni, which appeared after the Gunderson, Rödl and Sidorenko result and improved it in the case when d equals 3. So our bound recovers this. I know it's a bit difficult to keep track of all these exponents. So what I did in the next slide is collect a table with some concrete numbers to get the feeling for how these results are different from each other. What is this table? So there are four columns. The first column corresponds to the uniformity. The second column corresponds to, involves numbers that correspond to the deletion bound. I'll mention in a second what they are. And the third column number that corresponds to the Gunderson, Rödl and Sidorenko bound. And the last column numbers that correspond to our result. So what are the numbers? A number alpha in the D throw means that the corresponding method gives the lower bound n to the d minus 1 over alpha for the extremal function of k2 to 2. So I underline some values to see some examples. So for instance, I'm not sure if you can see the cursor, but the first thing that I underline, the 3 from the last column tells us that indeed our result recovers this lower bound construction of Katz, Krop, and Maggioni, namely, the construction in that case provide has n to the 3 minus 1 over 3 hyperedges. When the uniformity is 5, so it's the 7 that's underlined, this corresponds to the bound n to the 5 minus 1 over 7 in uniformity d equals 5. I also underlined a power of 2, and you can check all of them in this list. It turns out that our bound and the Gunderson, Rödl, Sidorenko bound get the same expression. So for instance, in uniformity 16, one has this bound, a construction with n to the 16 minus 1 over 4096 hyperedges. It's also perhaps worth emphasizing that the first uniformity where our result gives a new construction is the case d equals 5. So in that case, the 7 is the first number that's larger than the corresponding number in the third column. Okay. So before I tell you about the proof, I'd like to say some things, first address a possibly interesting consequence of this result. So the fact that our construction improves over the deletion bound for all uniformities has an interesting consequence. So one gets the following counting result that generalizes the classical theorem of Kleiman and Winston from 82. So what does this counting result say? For any d greater than 2, the number of labeled copy, the number of labeled d uniform hypergraphs on the set 1 to n without copies of k2 to 2 is at most 2 to the power a constant times this extremal function. And this is optimal up to the choice of the constant c that depends on the uniformity d. The result of Kleiman and Winston is the case d equals 2, which said that the number of k to 2 free graphs on 1 to n is at most 2 to the extremal number, which in that case is known to be n to the 3 halves up to a constant. And this follows, so the proof of this follows from a more general result of Ferber, McKinley, and Samotish, which said that any polynomial gain over the deletion bound for any uniform hypergraph provides this counting result. So the fact that this fraction to the d minus 1 divided by d is not an integer works precisely in this favor. A second thing I would like to address briefly is the regime when SD is significantly larger than S1, S2, SD minus 1, because this is a rather different situation where not much was known until recently. So in 2018, Ma, Yuan, and Zhang proved the following remarkable result. So for every integers S1 up to SD minus 1 greater than 2, there exists a very large positive constant C depending on S1, S2, and SD minus 1, such that for all S sub D's greater than C, this extremal function for the general Zarankiewicz problem for hypergraphs is matches the Erdős upper bound. So this is precisely of the order of n to the d minus 1 over the product of the first values of the SIs. I should say, however, that the expression very large in the parenthesis is quite literal. So already in the case d equals 2, where this is known with a precise value, but with this method of I should say that this was proved using the random algebraic method of Buch, introduced in 2015 to provide an alternative argument for the case for the graph situation. And I should say that already in the case of graphs, this alternative argument provides a very poor bound on C in terms of S1. So as far as I know, in that argument, one can only take C to be of tower type, a tower of twos of length depending on S1. Which could be possibly optimized. However, it's far from the threshold of determined by the norm and projective norm graphs of Along, Kolar, Ronya, and Sabo. So it's still an interesting question to us what quantitative bounds we can provide for this result. And turns out it's not too difficult to modify these norm graphs appropriately to prove that this extremal function matches the Erdős upper bound already as soon as SD is larger than this factorial plus 1, d minus 1 times S1 times S2 times SD minus 1 factorial plus 1. So a quantity which when d equals 2 is precisely S minus 1 minus 1. S1 minus 1 factorial plus 1, the threshold in the graph case. Okay, this is a good moment to pause. If there are any questions, because I'll move on to say a few words now about the proof. So, okay, there are no questions. I'll continue. So before I tell you about our idea, I'd like to revisit the main idea behind the Gunderson, Rödl and Sidorenko argument, because it's an argument that we build upon. So like in the usual deletion argument, they begin by considering D groups of n vertices. Here n, you should think about it as q to the power s. So the first D minus one groups of vertices are just sets without any further structure. The last one, however, is considered to be a copy of the S-dimensional vector space over FQ. And now the random graph is defined as follows. So for each D minus one tuple of vertices, one from each of the first D minus one groups, I will assign a random hyperplane in the last copy, which I'll denote by H sub V1 comma V2 comma V sub D minus one. The assignment is uniform in the sense that each of the hyperplane is equally likely. And now I'll define the hyperedges to consist of all the D tuples of the form V1, V2, Vd minus one, and V, V being in the last set, where V is in this hyperplane H of V1, V2, Vd minus one. So for each D minus one tuple, I have a hyperplane there, and what is the main observation? So if one looks at the K2 2, so a box, we have two vertices in each group. And for each of these 2 to the D minus one hyperplanes corresponding to the D minus one tuples of vertices in the first D minus one groups, I have a picture that looks like this, where each of these hyperplanes must pass through the two points completing this copy of K222 in V. And the structure, the additional structure in the last set now allows us to use the fact that if these hyperplanes contain, all contain these two points, well, they must contain the full line through them. So now if I'd like to do a deletion argument in the style of the one I described before, well, I delete an edge, a hyper edge from each copy of K222, I can delete edges a bit more carefully. Namely, I can win a factor of Q because this line passing through the last two points that's common to all the 2D minus one hyperplanes has the feature that every two points on this line forms a K222 with these other 2D minus two points in the previous groups. So it's not just the two vertices here, the original ones that form this K222, but any other two points on this line form a K222. And so the way I can destroy all these K222 is by deleting all the edges involving these 2D minus two points and all the points on this line. And so I delete by a factor of Q less edges than K222s form by all these points. Because, they're K squared choices of pairs of points on this line. And if I just remove the edges along D tuples with D minus one points from the previous D minus one groups and the points on that line, well, I just remove Q of the Q points rather than Q squared. So that's where there's a game. Of course, so this the so this does not quite work so cleanly. So what they actually have to do is not consider hyperplanes, but rather fix the codimension and look at the set of affine subspaces of that codimension and optimize for the codimension in terms of S. But this is roughly the idea. And this strange condition on the uniformity that they have and the hypothesis comes from this the set of inequalities that one has to remove less edges than a constant proportion of the total number of edges, and one would like to improve on the deletion bound. So this given the fact that dimensions are integers, the set of inequalities is incompatible when dn to the d minus one are not relatively prime. Okay, so this is their setup. What we do is the following. So our idea is to essentially do the same kind of construction. However, we're gonna add structure, not just in the last piece, but in all the other d minus one blobs. So all of the copies here, all the groups vi would be copies of fq to ds now, the same s-dimensional vector space over fq. And now we would like to assign random hyperplanes in such a way, or rather codimension r affine subspaces in such a way such that when we x-ray a given copy of K222, we don't just see a funny bone in this last set V that has this nice feature that every 2 points on this common line forms a K222 with the 2D minus 2 points in the previous groups, but we see the full skeleton of this K222, namely we'll see a similar such line in each group. And so we'll see the line passing through the 2 points from V1, a line passing through the 2 points from V2, a line passing through the 2 points from VI, and so on. And now each of these lines would like to have the same feature that every 2 points on the line, let's say in VI, will form K222 with any two D minus two tuple formed by choosing 2 points on each of the other lines that are present in the other group. And that will give us a gain of not just Q, but a gain of Q to the D. So a Q coming from each group by a similar argument from before. So we'll similarly like to remove then, to do a deletion argument, but remove less edges. Okay. So that's roughly the idea. How to make this more precise? How do we assign these random hyperplanes? Or we're gonna use random multilinear maps. So here's some terminology. Let V1 up to VD be finite dimensional vector spaces over FQ. And I'm gonna identify this space of multilinear functions from this Cartesian product of the VIs to FQ with the tensor product of the corresponding dual spaces. And for us, a uniformly random multilinear map from this Cartesian product to FQ will be a random element of this tensor product chosen according to the uniform distribution. Furthermore, if for each I we have a subspace UI that's contained in VI, we can define a restriction map from the tensor product of the dual spaces of the VIs to the tensor product of the dual space of the UIs. And a very simple and yet crucial property of this restriction map that we will use is that it's well behaved with respect to choosing uniformly random elements in these corresponding spaces, namely the restriction R of t of a uniformly random multilinear function t is uniformly random in the smaller space, U1 star tensor, U2 star tensor, UD star. And this has to do with the fact that there is this restriction map is surjective, and even more than that, each element in the smaller space has the same number of in the codomain has the same number of pre-images in the U1 star tensor with VD star. And now one can make that more precise. Okay, so what is the construction? We fix positive integers D, R, and S, and Q is a prime power. And we let T1 up to TR be just independent, uniformly random multilinear functions from the default Cartesian product of V with itself. V here is the is FQ to the S. And we're gonna define the D partite, the uniform hypergraph on V to the D, on D copies of V to be, to have as edges the D tuples V1 up to VD, such that all these tensors TI send the tuple V1 up to VD to 1. So that is in some sense like assigning a codimension R affine subspace at random in the last blob V if you keep V1 up to VD minus 1 fixed. Okay. So in this construction, what do we actually prove? So if R and S are chosen such that this inequality is satisfied, which you can ignore for now, then on average, one can remove little o of the number of edges in this hypergraph and destroy all the copies of K222. So if I can convince you that the expected number of edges in H is of the order of Q to the power D times S minus R, then this will lead to a construction of a D uniform H, well, on D times Q to the S vertices, and roughly still Q to the D times S minus R edges, because we only remove little o of that number. And so if I denote by N this quantity D times Q to the power S, then the number of edges is of the order of N to the D minus R over S. So if this inequality between D and D, S and R is satisfied, I can choose R to be equal to 1 and S to be the ceiling function. Ceiling function of 2 to the d minus 1 divided by d, it's easy to see that this choice satisfies the inequality, again, given the fact that d never divides 2 to the d minus 1. And so this will lead us to a construction of desired number of edges, d minus this reciprocal of the ceiling function. So this is the setup. I'd like to formalize a little bit this sketch that I discussed. So there are three key estimates that come into the proof. First of all, we'll need an estimate for the expected number of edges of H, which I promised to be of the order of Q to the D times S minus R. In fact, one can write a precise equality. We'll need an estimate on the number of copies of K222 present in this random uniform hypergraph. And lastly, and perhaps most interestingly, we'll need an estimate on the number of hyperedges that we'll remove in order to destroy all the copies of K222 in our hypergraph H. So, I'll introduce this notation. Let B be the family of all these D tuples of vertices, V1 up to VD, for which there exists another d tuple v1 prime up to vd prime, completing the k222 with the d tuple v1 up to vd. And it's enough to remove this family of edges in order to destroy all the k222s by design. So if I can control the size of B, then I'll be able to do a deletion argument that gives a lower bound on the number of edges. And the key estimate is that this expected size of B is at most the expected number of copies of k222 divided by q to the d. So this is this extra factor of q to the d. This is this gain that comes from adding structure to each blob. So it's crucial in order to gain over the GRS bound. Okay, so if you accept these numbers here, one would now like to have this inequality between R, S, and D in order for the right-hand side of this expression to be strictly less than the expected number of edges in order for us to still have a significant number of edges left in the hypergraph after we destroy all the copies of K222. So if one plugs in the first two estimates, we would like this inequality to be satisfied between the exponents. And it is satisfied because that's the condition essentially that that was added there. So we would be done. This would lead to the construction. So in the remaining time, I like to tell you about how to prove the estimate number three, since I think it's the most interesting one. I'll also just try to convince you at least of the first estimate. So the first two are more rather technical computations, but they're not difficult. So let me maybe say out loud a couple of things about the expected number of edges. So the first term here, this is the total number of eligible d tuples v1 up to vd that can be edges. In other words, note that if an element of a d tuple to zero, a tensor Ti can never send the d tuple to one, it will send it to zero. So all the d tuples in v to the d that can be edges must consist of must have non-zero coordinates. So this first term here is the number of d tuples with non-zero coordinates. And now for a fixed d tuple v1 up to vd, q to the minus r is the probability that these r tensors send v1 up to vd to one. And of course, we to see this, one would just like to show that to say that, uniformly random single tensor t1 has the probability of sending v1 up to vd to one equal to one over q. And since these tensors are independent to each other, the probability that all of them will send v1 up to vd to q to one is equal with q to the minus r. So the way this follows simply by using this property of the restriction map, that the restriction of uniformly random tensor to a smaller Cartesian product consisting of subspaces is also uniformly random if we just think of it as a tensor on that Cartesian product. So slightly more concretely, the idea is that given a d-tuple v1 up to vd, if one considers the one-dimensional vector spaces generated by v1, v2 up to vd respectively, So let's call them big V1, big V2, and big Vd. Well, a tensor being one on the d-tuple completely characterizes the tensor on this Cartesian product of one-dimensional subspaces generated by these elements, little v1, little v2, little vd. And since the restriction of a tensor to this one-dimensional tensor product of dual spaces of one-dimensional vector spaces is uniformly random, then the probability of it sending v1 up to vd2 to 1 is equal with 1 over q. I know this is a rather technical computation, so I didn't want to write more. I'll skip the second one. So a similar argument enables one to compute the expected number of copies of K222. Similarly, one will have to look at the vector spaces generated by each pair of vertices forming the K222, and look at the restriction of the tensor on this smaller Cartesian product, which is uniformly random. Okay, so I'll move on to the third estimate, which is the most interesting. So in order to prove this claim on the expected size of B, I'll introduce the notation. So given a sequence of affine lines L1 up to LD and FQ to DS, I'll denote by P of L1 up to LD the set of all sequences, so the 2D tuples of vertices, such that XJ and XJ prime are on the line LJ and they're distinct for all J. So essentially this is the set of 2D tuples where I choose 2 points per line. And clearly this has size roughly Q to the 2D. Moreover, every K222 is contained in the P of L1 up to LD for some choice of lines, because I can simply consider the lines passing through the 2 points from each group. And if I give you 2 distinct tuples of lines, well, these families of sequences do not overlap, just because the d tuple of lines L1 up to LD completely characterizes this set of sequences P of L1 up to LD. Okay, so a third property that is crucial about this set of sequences P of L1 up to LD is the following. So by round F, I denoted essentially the full collection of copies of K222 in our hypergraph H. So this is the set of 2D tuples that are sent to one by our tensors. So the third property says that if there is something in the intersection of P of L1 up to LD with F, and in other words, if the lines L1 up to LD see a K222 where there are 2 vertices per line, then in fact, well, all of P of L1 up to LD is in F. Namely, we will have a K222 between any 2 points from line 1, any 2 points from line 2, any 2 points from line 3, any 2 points from line LD. So as soon as the lines L1 up to LD see one K222, they see a lot of K222s. And this just follows from multilinearity. Since I'm running a bit out of time, I'll just skip this computation. It's very easy. Essentially, every point on the line passing through 2 points, V0 and V1 in group I can be written as a linear combination, so a point UI is can be written as alpha I VI plus alpha I alpha 0 V0 plus alpha 1 V1, and if we have the information that the VIs with supercript 0 and 1 for Mk 222, well, I know that these tensors send all these 2 to the d tuples to 1, and I can just plug in this this expression for the UIs and note that t also sends the d tuple u1 up to ud to 1 from multilinearity. And so I get edges between any d tuple obtained by choosing one point per line. So the three properties, essential properties of the set of sequences, P of L1 up to LD, are the following. Just to recap, every K222 is contained in one of these sequences. For every two distinct tuples of lines, these set of sequences, these sets of sequences do not overlap. And if there is a K222 in a pencil of lines, then this pencil of lines generates a lot of K222. So every 2 points per line form a K222. So one can use these three pieces to get this upper bound on the number of edges B that one needs to remove in order to destroy all the copies of K22 in our hypergraph. So if we denote by L, the collection of interesting L tuple, D tuples of lines, so namely the D tuples of lines that generate some K222 by choosing 2 points from each, the size of L is given by this equality. So the size of L times the cardinality of the set of sequences, PL1, L2, LD, which is precisely this Q, the D times Q minus one to the D, because there are Q options to choose each first point from the line, and then Q minus one options to choose the second point. This is equal with the size size of F, the number of K22s in total in H. On the other hand, every edge in our hypergraph that is involved in some K222 must be present in some Cartesian product of lines in L, just by the way we define L. And furthermore, this holds with equality. So namely, as soon as we pick d tuples of lines in L from the right-hand side, well, and any d tuple of points where I choose one from each line will be involved in a K22 by the definition of L. So there's nothing left out from B. Nothing left out from the union that is not in B. So we have this equality, and a simple union bound gives an upper bound for B in terms of L and Q to the D. Each line has Q points on it. And plugging in the equality above gives an upper bound for B in terms of the size of F. So taking expected values, one gets an expected an upper bound for the expected number of edges one needs to remove in order to destroy all copies of K22. And afterwards, one proceeds by doing a deletion argument and gets this construction. So this is the end of the proof. I'll also end here. Thank you very much for listening.
All right, let's all a Newton clap and thank Cosmin. Okay, are there any questions? I'll stop recording.